Hi there, and welcome to this lecture on Process Flow Diagrams, Equipment Summary Tables. My name is Marina Miletic. Let's next look at an equipment summary table for reactors, towers, and vessels. These three may seem like they might not have a lot in common, but in the end, they're all more or less cylindrical vessels, just with different internals and conditions. Let's first look at orientation. Remember that ChemCAD or Aspen will not choose the equipment orientation for you, so you won't find this information under equipment specifications. Let's briefly look at orientation choices for reactors and separators. Reactors can be horizontally or vertically oriented, depending on the type used. Plug flow and packed bed reactors are often horizontal. Fluidized and moving bed reactors are often vertical, and CSTRs and other agitated reactors are also usually considered vertical. I recommend choosing the orientation based on the flow of the fluids through the unit. If gases are moving upward, such as in a fluidized bed, choose vertical. If fluids are moving across a bed or through horizontal tubes, choose horizontal. If liquid is being poured into the reactor, choose vertical. Regarding the orientation of towers and flashes, these are almost always of vertical orientation, since this facilitates vapor-liquid separation and separation based on density. And regarding the orientation of vessels such as these vessels are examples of horizontal and vertical accumulators. Horizontal tanks are typically used for smaller volumes, such as for holding and draining a reflux stream for a smaller distillation column. Vertical accumulators are usually used when you need a vessel that can hold a large amount of liquid, but also has a small footprint. It's also used for vapor-liquid mixtures when you may need to vent or flare vapors. For our ethylene oxide process, I chose a horizontal orientation for our reactor, since it's a packed bed with catalyst contained in a horizontal shell. For the distillation columns and flashes, I chose a vertical orientation because columns and flashes need to be vertical to facilitate vapor-liquid separation. Let's next look at specifying materials of construction. Again, ChemCAD or Aspen will not select these for you, so we must look at the temperature and chemical composition of the streams coming in and going out of these units to determine the most durable yet cheapest material to use. Be sure to base your selection on the temperature range of the streams coming in and going out, and their chemical reactivity, potential for corrosion or oxidative damage, and pH. Potentially damaging chemicals are what make more expensive materials a requirement. For our ethylene oxide process, I chose 316 stainless steel for reactor R101 because I'm aware of the high oxygen content of the inlet stream, and I wanted to choose a material that would not compete or interfere with the main reaction. Since the products are fairly unreactive and at a temperature below 500 degrees centigrade, I chose carbon steel for the flashes and the first distillation column. I chose 316 stainless steel for the final tower because it has a high concentration of ethylene oxide. The next set of information is important for verifying the conditions under which each of these units are running. For each piece of equipment, be sure to include the inlet flow rate, temperature, pressure, and vapor fraction. If you're using process simulation software, this information can be copied and pasted from the stream table. Notice the properties of the outlet stream or streams are not listed. This is because flashes and towers have two or more streams exiting the vessel, and listing the physical properties of all of these streams would be cumbersome and would result in an overly cluttered table. Next, let's look at specifying dimensions. First, the height of a vertical reactor, tower, or vessel, or the length of a horizontal reactor or vessel. Neither reactor length nor diameter will be given to you by ChemCAD or Aspen. These dimensions need to be calculated by hand, and they entirely depend on the type of reactor being used. Many students believe that since ChemCAD or Aspen give them a volume, such as 5 meters cubed for their reactor, they can just guess at a length and diameter, and as long as the cross-sectional area times the height equals the volume given in ChemCAD or Aspen, then the numbers are accurate. This is not a good approach. Reactor vessel dimensions depend on factors such as the average time the reactants and products are in the reactor, If solids are being suspended, the volume required to reach and maintain minimum fluidizing velocity to allow for mixing, the placement of the packing in the reactor and its density, the necessary void space in the reactor to allow for reactants and products to flow through, if tubes are being used, their placement, diameter, and length, if the catalyst is packed into a space such as tubes, the pressure drop across that volume, and many other factors. It would take an entire semester to explain how to design a reactor and determine its dimensions, so I suggest that based on your process, you should first look in literature to determine which kind of reactor has been used for the same or similar processes in the past. This is a good starting point for designing your reactor and determining its dimensions. Once you know what kind of reactor is most appropriate for your process, I suggest you look at a chemical reaction engineering book, such as the one written by Scott Fogler, Elements of Chemical Reaction Engineering, for more guidance on sizing, use of tubes or trays, pressure drop, mixing, and other factors. Thanks for watching.